मैं राम्य राज चौधरी, रीजनल सेल्स हेड ईस्ट, SBU वेकेशंस एक्सोटिका, बेलमर लॉरी एंड कंपनी लिमिटेड। हैविंग ओवर 19 इयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस इन द ट्रैवल एंड टूरिज्म इंडस्ट्री, मिस्टर रॉय चौधरी हैज़ बीन प्रीवियसली एसोसिएटेड विद रेनाउंड ब्रांड्स लाइक SOTC ट्रैवल एंड सर्विसेज, कॉक्स एंड किंग्स, गेनवेल एंटरप्राइजेज एक्सेट्रा। ही हैज़ बीन अ कॉन्स्टेंट सपोर्ट टू आर डिपार्टमेंट सिंस मेनी ईयर्स। मिस्टर रॉय चौधरी many has also supported our department, as many of our existing students as well as alumni have been working in his industry and in his organizations. Recently, even amidst the COVID-19 pandemic, also he has been given selected opportunities to few of the students. Now I'd like to request sir to please proceed with the session. Sir, over to you.
I think sir is muted.
Sir, you are muted, sir.
Is it okay now? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
You're audible.
Okay. So, good evening, all of you. Thank you so much, Mr. Nanda and Vandita, for organizing this session. As Mr. Nanda has already introduced me, thank you so much for having briefed on this subject, sir. It's going to be an interactive session, as I have already discussed with Vandita on the matter. Why it has to be an interactive session and not a one-way communication? The main reason behind that is, I am from the sales trade. I am from the sales background. I'm associated with the industry for almost 15 to 16 years now, and all throughout these time, the only thing that I have done is I have been selling international and domestic tours. And I'm still selling all these destinations amid this unpredictable COVID situation. So all throughout, I had been someone who had been interacting with my clients. I had been interacting with my industry partners. So it was a two-way communication. You are also a lot which is planned and destined to be in the industry maybe in the next 1 to 1.5 years. So I would request all of you to speak up, ask me questions, clear your doubts, and make this a very interesting interactive session so that there is a two-way communication. I would like to start my presentation with a few slides to give you an idea as to where I belong, what I have done, and what we are planning ahead during this COVID time and ahead of COVID time also. Vandita, if you can just guide me on having the slides in the screen.
Sure, sir. Sir, the same option, sir, you can go to the share content option, which is there. And if your PPT is open, then it will show up.
Can you see my PPT, the slides now?
Yes, sir, it is visible to us.
Okay. So currently I'm associated with Baman Lorry Company Limited, which is headquartered in Kolkata. I belong to one of the strategic business units, which is Vacations Exotica. The main business area of this particular SBU is leisure holidays as well as MICE vacations, customized tours, and yes, ticketing is also a part of our product portfolio since we are an IATA organization. Coming on to my past experiences, this is just a snapshot of my contributions to the industry. So I started back in 2005, fresh out of college, just like you once upon a time. I was placed in the international holiday sales department. So I was a seller. I started my career as a seller. And gradually I had taken up major assignments in the sense that...
Sir, sorry for interrupting. Yeah. You can just click on the this option, enlarge PPT, sir, so that the screen... No, you can just click on the enlarge option.
Is it okay now?
Yes. Please continue. Thank you.
Right. So I started my journey in the travel industry back in 2005. I had joined SOTC Travel Limited as an international package seller. Then I gradually scaled up my responsibilities as a branch head of our franchisee in Bhubaneswar, Odisha. I had spent 1 year over there as a sales manager. Now, being a sales manager, I was in charge of both sales and operations. I was the person who was doing the PR in that market. I was into corporate sales. So whatever is required to generate a sale for a business division, I was a part of it. 2008 to 9, I was posted in Gangtok in Sikkim as a manager of the business outlet over there. Responsibilities more or less was the same while it was a bigger market, because Gangtok being the center, the capital of Sikkim. So I had to handle the entire Sikkim market by being posted in Gangtok. Yes, I had changed the company in 2008. So after SOTC travel, I had joined Cox & Kings Limited. 2009, I was brought back to Calcutta as a territory sales manager. And from 2009 till the end of 2015, I had executed as an area sales manager. And I had worked in almost all the leisure markets of East India. In the sense, I was working in Bengal, being posted in Kolkata. I was traveling to Assam, so the Guwahati market also I was handling at that time. Sikkim was a part of my territory, because I already knew the Sikkim market because I was posted there for a year. Odisha market is like my second home, so the Odisha was also a part of my territory. Jharkhand and Bihar were also a part of my territory. These were newer markets. I was learning, I was becoming a part of these markets. So these span of 6 to 7 years had been a very crucial period of my career, in the sense that I had learned how to conduct marketing, how to develop PR, how to sell, what type of marketing actions are to be taken in these markets. 2015 onwards, I was a part of SOTC Travel Limited once again, back to my parent organization. And here the assignment, the responsibilities increased. So along with B2C, I was doing B2B also. So here the responsibilities was a broader one, along with handling direct clients. I was expanding the B2B market also. I was appointing our sales agents over there. Franchisee appointment was also a part of my job responsibility. The markets almost remained the same. It was Bengal, Assam, Tripura, Sikkim, Odisha, Jharkhand, and Bihar. So it has been a very, very enriching experience, I can tell you, from 2005 to 2020, in the sense that I had a very solid understanding of the ground realities in this market. Because frankly speaking, what works in Kolkata doesn't work in Gangtok. What is best for Gangtok doesn't work in Ranchi. So each and every state has got its individuality. The mindset of the people are different. The type of product that sells in Kolkata market is not accepted in Jamshedpur or Dhanbad market. So we had to plan individual. We had to have individual strategies for each and every market. We had to have a separate approach, in the sense that we had done something else in Jamshedpur and aiming at the same objective, we had to travel a second route while we were in Ranchi. So each and every market has got an individuality, a characteristic of its own. And we had to plan our marketing strategy. In fact, we had to plan separate products also. The same destination, Europe, for an example, was sold with a different itinerary in Dhanbad than what we used to sell in Ranchi or what we used to sell in Guwahati. So understanding the dynamics of these markets, understanding the customers, understanding the travel period, and even understanding the type of products had been a vital learning during this tenure. And that is something I would love to share with all of you. Now, coming on to my current organization, all of you must be knowing Baum & Lawry as an organization. Some of you have already completed their internships with us. So it's a diversified business conglomerate being based out of Kolkata. Kolkata is the headquarters of the organization. We have 5 joint ventures and 2 subsidiaries in India and abroad. We are into corporate travel. In the travel segment, we are into logistics. Barmen Lorry is the biggest steel barrel producer in the country. We have manufacturing units in the industrial greases and lubricant segment. Here you can have the business verticals of Barmen Lorry. So there is a greases and lubricant strategic business unit. We have an industrial packaging SBU. We are into leather chemicals, travel and vacations. I am a part of this SBU. We have refinery and oil field services. That is a separate business division. We have subsidiaries in Vizag as well as in UK. And there are joint venture initiatives also, both in India as well as overseas. Talking about Vacations Exotica, Barmen Lorry as an organization has taken over Vacations Exotica back in 2014. And today Vacations Exotica is into MICE. It is into leisure travel. We are an IATA organization catering to the corporate tour segment. Business travel is also a part of our product portfolio. These are the activities where Vacations Exotica has got its expertise. We are into the MICE segment where we organize meetings, incentive travel, we organize conferences and events. We have group departures to almost all the destinations across the world. Europe, USA, Australia, and New Zealand are the most famous group departures where we have a lot of quality customers traveling throughout the year. We have an individual tour division where we customers tours to both the domestic and international destinations. We book cruises throughout the world. We are into rail bookings, international rail bookings being part of our product portfolio. We are into self-drive vacations. We are into ticketing, visa processing, hotel bookings, both in India and international. We are into car rentals. We have implant offices in some of the biggest corporates, both in Calcutta and across India. We have offshore travel outlets. Now, something about the USPs of Vacations Exotica. See, this is an organization which is in the market for the past 150 years. Travel and tourism is a part of the entire business portfolio. It is into numerous other business segments where it has been operating very profitably, and its execution has been consistent. That's why the organization is still running, and it has already completed 150 years of its existence. So we are into value creation for our clients. It's a customer-driven organization where we respond to our customers' needs. We plan itineraries and vacations meticulously for our clients. While on tour also, we take regular updates from our clients. We respond to any area in which the service delivery has not worked in the way it should be. We work out a resolution immediately. We have a team that's young, dynamic, and passionate in creating travel itineraries suitable for the markets in East India. And yes, since it's a 150-year strong organization, we have customers who are very loyal to Vacations Exotica. And they have been traveling with us year on year. We also get a lot of contacts from them. They recommend Vacations Exotica services to their friends and relatives, through which also we get a lot of fresh contacts. These are snapshots of some of the group departures to Europe that we have been doing throughout these years. We are covering at least 14 to 15 countries in Europe. We have a lot of itinerary options, and these itineraries spread from 7 days till 15 days. we also were having, were conducting our group departures to both USA and Canada. Group departures were being conducted to destinations across the world. Like here you can see, we had group departures to Egypt. We had group departures to South Africa, to Kenya, Tanzania. We had group departures to Australia, to New Zealand. We had New Zealand and Australia with Fiji combinations also. Now coming to the current times, the COVID time, COVID has posed a big, big challenge to the travel industry, as all of you are aware of. These are some of the products that we have developed as of now, two locations where we think a customer can travel without any hassle and with at least some amount of guarantee to the health and hygiene factors. So we have weekend destination which are covering the beaches, religious destinations, there are some historical destinations, and these are all destinations which are within drivable distance out of Kolkata. So for someone who want to drive his vehicle on his own, we have two, three options within the beaches segment. We have Shantiniketan as a leisure destination option. We have Tarapit and Navadvip as religious destinations. We have Vishnupur and Murshidabad within the historical destination segment. There is a big demand for eco-resort packages with cottage and tent accommodation that's in the market. As you can understand, COVID spreads through population. I mean, you don't have to, I don't have to do anything. If I come close to you, there is a possibility of the virus getting transmitted in both directions. So this particular factor has given rise to a requirement where families would not like to stay with other families, or at least should they are expecting some gap between their individual entities and a second or a third entity. And this requirement has given up a demand for eco-tourism packages. These eco resorts had already been existing in the market. It is not that the resorts and the hotels have cropped up all at a sudden. These were already existing, but this current COVID situation has cropped up a sudden demand for these type of resort-based packages. So we have options that is catering to this particular segment. Heritage property stays somehow has catered to this requirement where a person can stay in the zamindar buildings. I mean, there are a lot of zamindar buildings in and around Calcutta. These buildings have been renovated, they have been refurbished, and they are now being utilized for small families to stay for weekend durations, maybe for two nights or three nights. Secluded homestays. Homestays had been a segment that has been struggling to come up in a big way in the last 2 to 3 years. Maybe the COVID situation is a big boon to them. Now, I mean, everyone is asking for homestays, because homestays, if you stay in a homestay accommodation, maybe max to max you are sharing that particular building with one or two families. So density is lower, you don't get an opportunity to interact with a lot of people. It's a secluded accommodation, and these are all resorts that has been brought up in exotic locations, in the villages mainly, like the homestays in Darjeeling and Sikkim. These are all located in secluded locations, having fantastic views, not very few, less population density. So this current demand has cropped up in the market. There is a lot of demand in the market for homestays as well as for the bungalow stays. Jungle safari and jungle trails is an upcoming demand with the coming winter season. You will find a lot of people traveling to Jaldapada Forest Reserve. People will also travel to Madhya Pradesh. They will go to Karnataka, and they will be staying inside the forests where the state tourism hotels or the private bungalows inside the forest reserve or the outside the forest reserve will also be catering to this particular demand of the market. Self-drive vacation is something that is coming up in a big way. As I mentioned earlier, for distances of 200 to 250 kilometer out of Calcutta, people would love to drive their vehicle on their own. They may be staying in a hotel, or they may be staying in a heritage property, or a homestay, or a bungalow stay, whatever it is, people are preferring to drive on their own. So in that way, self-drive vacations is a package of tomorrow, I can say, looking at current demand in the market. These are some weekend products we have come up with. Looking at the weekend destination demand in the market, we have Mandarmani and Digha within the beach resort segment. We have Shantiniketan for 2 nights and 3 days in the leisure segment. We have got Tarapit as an option for the religious minded people who were unable to travel to these destinations for since the last 3-4 months. We have Murshidabad and Bishnupur as historical destinations. And yes, we are getting a lot of inquiries for these two locations also. And the nature of all these packages are, like, these are all customized vacations. There is no fixed departure. Any one of you, anytime planning to have a weekend excursion to any of these destinations, a vehicle will be provided to you that will pick you up from your residence. The vehicle along with the driver will be with you throughout the entire duration that you are staying in the destination, and that vehicle will also drop you back to your destination. We have chosen the best hygienic and luxury properties in all these destinations, which are following the COVID protocols, so that our customers at least get some form of comfort and confidence when they are staying in these properties. And the local sightseeing are also being covered in the vehicle that we are providing. And yes, the driver that we are providing is a trained person. This driver is also thoroughly trained in maintaining COVID protocols. And this driver is someone who has got previous experience of handling both international and domestic clients across all these destinations. These are the long haul options that we have made ready looking into the upcoming inquiries. See, not many people are traveling or moving out of Kolkata or out of Bengal at the moment. The only people who are traveling are all business travelers or families who were stranded in Kolkata earlier and now returning back to their home. Some of them are also moving because it's a festive season. There is going to be a lot of movement. But we have kept all these options ready in the sense that once the things open up and people get back their confidence, their morale is high, then these are the destinations that the people are going to travel. So, frankly speaking, summer is the biggest travel season for Indians. The month of April, May and June sees the biggest tourist movements to both domestic and international destinations. But unfortunately, 2-3 months starting from the last week of March till the last week of May had been a very dull time. People could not move. They were confined inside their home. The overall scenario was very, very abnormal. Like, we human beings are not made to stay indoor. We are made to stay both indoor as well as move outdoor. So we had gone against our human quality and stayed inside the four walls for about 2-3 months at a stretch. This particular frustration has given rise to a big demand in market, but that's a demand which you cannot see, but it's a big demand that has cropped up. And once things starts opening up, we are expecting a boom in the market. Now, I mean, when that particular time is going to come depends on how fast the vaccine will come and it will reach you, it will reach me, and finally we have the confidence and then move out. But yes, tourism is something that is going to stay. People are going to move, whether for vacation or whether for business need or for meeting friends and relatives. Movement is something which is going to continue. So though it's a very dull stage at the moment, but I mean, it cannot be worse than this. So whatever happens in future, we all expect it's going to be a positive thing. It's going to be a healthy thing. Some other options, like we have got Gujarat in our portfolio, we have Andaman. We are coming up with circuits that is covering the UNESCO World Heritage Sites like Mahabalipuram, Tanjore. We have itineraries on Karnataka. We have Meghalaya and Assam combination. Kumayun is going to be a big destination next year, the next summer. Yes, there are a lot of people who will travel during the Christmas and New Year time also. Goa has already opened up. The only destination where which is finding the maximum footfall at this moment is definitely Goa. We have kept ready the Golden Triangle, the Delhi, Agra and Jaipur segment. This particular slide will talk about my personal observations and what I think we should work at this particular moment. I feel that there should be a balance between community and tourism. Destinations are expected to be more vigilant and prioritize a fine balance between capacity and business expectations. See, there are a lot of countries like Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore, and Hong Kong who could have opened up their borders for Indian passengers 2 to 3 months back, but somehow they did not do it. There were reasons for the decision that they had taken. This time they had been utilizing to take a proper stock of things. They were assessing whether this huge movement out of India would, I mean, they would be able to handle, or the movement out of India will go out of control once those people arrive over there. The local population gets affected through tourism. So this is a time during which the destinations, the local governments, the tourism boards are in a constant stage of homework, assessing whether they have sufficient and suitable resources to handle tourism or not. So that's why my take on this particular idea is the destinations are expected to be more vigilant and prioritize fine balance between capacity and business expectations. If I have a high business expectation, but I don't have the infrastructure or the resources to cater to my expectation or my ambition, then it's going to be a big accident. By having a proper assessment, they will have a better view of their actual handling capacity. They can take control of existing inventory and also standardize service delivery through standard operating procedures. Tourism definitely brings a lot of additional revenue to every country. But at the same time, every government's first priority is towards the well-being of the local population. Their local people should be happy, they should be safe, they should be sound, and then only tourism is going to prosper. So the well-being and concern for the local population will always top the priority list of every government. So once the Singapore or the Hong Kong authorities finally take a decision, they are convinced that yes, we have the infrastructure to handle tourism, then only the borders are going to open up. Quality improvement at destinations and entertainment facilities. See, COVID is not only a virus that has rocked the world. COVID has raised a lot of questions. COVID has raised a question in the sense that how well are the destinations equipped to handle an uncertainty, a situation like this. So a thorough relook and reorganization of facilities at attractions and places of interest is required. It is intended to eliminate opportunities of any cross-contamination. See, today it's COVID. Tomorrow it can be COVID A or COVID B. Now, how do we handle such situations? We can't have a lockdown each and every year. So a quality improvement at destinations as well as entertainment facilities like a zoo, or a museum that you are visiting, or a gallery you are visiting. How are these entities equipped, how well are they equipped to handle you, to provide you an ambience where you can enter a museum without any fear in your mind. It's a very important area that is definitely going to improve in future because COVID has already pushed us. Luxury travel is the way forward in the sense, like me or you or any third person deciding to travel in November or December with our family, we will obviously have a lot of questions in our mind. We would like to know the quality of the accommodation. If I'm checking into a hotel, what sort of a room will I have? What will be the level of housekeeping in that room? What will be the level of food that is served by the hotel? Will they be having a proper quality to protect me from the virus? Or they are still maintaining the standard that they used to have in the pre-COVID time? Transport. You land up at, for example, Chennai Airport. A car comes up and pick you up. Now you will have several questions on that car. Whether that car is a sanitized car, how frequently the sanitization is done. The person who is driving you the car, whether that person has got, is maintaining personal health and hygiene, is he taking care of himself, is he infected or he is not infected. So people are going to travel luxury in the sense that they are going to choose a hotel which has a long-standing reputation of quality. If you are selecting a transport, you are going to select the best car, the new cars, the branded ones. Service expectation will be very high in the sense that once you land up in your hotel, you will be very vigilant in observing whether the hotel authorities are following the local government protocols or not. And this will be true whether you are traveling to a domestic destination or you are traveling to an international destination. This is the current demand of the market. Customers who have traveled to Europe, to USA, to Australia, to New Zealand, they are struggling even to reach Delhi, Bombay, or maybe Chennai, or I mean Bagdogra at the moment. There are a lot of rules and regulations in every inch of ground that you step in. People are not habituated with so many protocols that has come up and that is pushing us every single second of our existence. I need to have a mask. I need to wash my hands 10 times a day. I need to have sanitizers ready on my table. See, these were never the regular practice of Indians or, I mean, across the world. But we have slowly adjusted to it. We have got a habit of maintaining these health standards. And these are going to be our expectations when we travel out also. Any hotel providing accommodation service to us, any restaurant providing food service to us, we will expect the same amount of health and sanitization SOPs to be maintained by them as well. The result will be service providers will gear up and reorganize their offerings to match this demand. If this is the demand of the market, the service providers have no other option but to cater to this demand. This is going to, I mean, give a big booster to the service delivery level at each and every level, I should say. Eco-friendly destinations, as I mentioned earlier, is the future of travel. For an example, if you had traveled to maybe Gangtok earlier and stayed somewhere near to the MG Marg area, you must have observed how densely populated the area is, how cramped the hotel buildings are. Between two buildings, there is no gap. And this is the trend of hotel accommodation, whether you are in Gangtok or you are in Darjeeling or you are in Shimla or you are in Manali. Eco-friendly destinations gives a lot of freedom to people in the sense that they are in a location which is not crowded. They are staying in a property which is not crowded. There is a lot of independence. There is a lot of fresh air. So there is a big demand of eco-friendly resorts all throughout the region. We are working on this segment also. So the market will look for pristine, pollution-free and clutter-free destinations that has got low population density. Coming on to the travel restrictions and SOPs, operators will apply and maintain stringent checks at every point. For an example, you are maybe traveling to Bangalore. So you will have to start complying and maintaining and supporting the authorities from Kolkata airport itself. There is a lot of regulation. There is no other way out. You need to adjust to it. You need to cooperate with the authorities. You need to say a yes to everything that the authorities implies on you so that you yourself is safe. So a lot of health and hygiene facilities at the points of service delivery. There's a lot of things going on. If you check into a hotel, you have to maintain the standard operating procedure that is being handed over to that hotel by the government authorities. If you're traveling to a zoo or if you're entering a museum or a gallery or even the big shopping malls, there is a lot of SOPs that you will, as of now, happily comply to. You will cooperate with the authorities. So you can understand that a lot of change is happening in the market. A lot of change is happening in the lives of people. You and me have never done all these things. It was never a necessary thing. But we are doing it. And in the process of doing it, we are upgrading ourselves. The overall services are getting upgraded. There is an overall quality improvement throughout this entire episode of COVID-19. That is what my observation is. Survival strategy for travel trade. It has already started. We are already practicing it. We are finding out new avenues of existing, or we are finding out new ways of marketing. We are developing new products. So what I think is that a cooperation and synergy between tourism service providers is very important at this stage. A conscious and deliberate move by tourism stakeholders. See, tourism, it's a bundled product. A package tour has got some contribution from airlines. Some percentage is contributed by the hoteliers, and then there are ground handlers also. So there has to be a synergy, a coordination, and a proper understanding between all the stakeholders, and all activities are towards a common objective of tourism revival. Synergy and coordination can only bring about the revival of the industry, and this has to be done through infrastructural modifications. If my hotel was never into sanitization earlier, I have to implement sanitization and health facilities. I have to start maintaining SOPs in the property. I have to comply to health protocols. I have to enable that my customer travels safe and return back safe without any sort of contamination. Product innovation. The type of product that used to be in the market pre-COVID, for an example, there were lakhs of people traveling to Europe, to USA, Australia, New Zealand, as well as other destinations pre-COVID time, traveling in groups, 40 people, 50 people, 200 people, 1,000 people traveling together in batches, returning to India in batches. This mode of travel is not going to continue because COVID has given us a lot of lessons, and the lessons are being learned in a very hard way. So group tours are not going to be the most preferred mode of traveling in the times to come. People are looking for a different approach, a different mode of travel, a different style of travel. So selecting appropriate destinations, accommodation and services in line with health protocols and well-being of passengers is very important. I need to have a product which will give utmost importance, priority and due diligence to the well-being of my customer. We have a feeling that tailor-made products are going to be the future of the travel market for quite some time now. So product innovation is something where we are regularly investing our time. We need to choose the appropriate marketing avenue also. The way in which a senior citizen product is being marketed or being promoted is going to be different than a college student or maybe a mid-aged person. Every particular product type has got a particular mode of travel from the product generator to the final consumer. So we have to innovate and work out these modes where we can have a faster reach to our target segment. We can have a clearer reach, and the customer is also able to access our product faster, understand our product better, and connect with us in a very efficient and hassle-free way. Educating the customer, I feel we were interacting with customers earlier also. But interacting with a customer is different than educating a customer. If you have a customer who would like to travel to Goa in the coming 1 to 3 months, you need to give them a lot of assurance, a lot of confidence. Confidence is required because people have lost their confidence. The morale is down. People do not have a lot of confidence. They don't know that if they step out of their home, they are going to return back safe and sound. That confidence is withered away by COVID. So there is a lot of confidence that we need to give to our customer. And this will require a very honest and candid discussion between the customer and the service provider. We need to be upfront in explaining the services and the standards we will be providing in our packages. We have to answer to a lot of queries that will come up from the customer side. At the same time, we need to give a lot of confidence. We have to boost the morale of our customer. Otherwise, traveling is going to take a long, long time to return back. It's not that people don't want to travel. The last 6-7 months has been a very trying time for Indian customers. The overall morale is down. People do not have confidence. In this situation, if the travel trade is not coming forward and passing on their message in a very positive way, develop some confidence, people are not going to travel. These are my observations as a survival strategy, because we have absorbed and this particular strategy, we have developed products, we have taken initiatives. It's a continuous process. We are still observing the market. We are interacting with our customers. We are taking feedback from our customers. And all these inputs are enabling us to develop a product that suits this particular time. Skills development for future professionals is definitely important, because there will be COVID situations in future also. And if we are not prepared, if we don't want to prepare, then similar situations are going to repeat. And it's always better that we have sufficient backup in advance. We do our homework so that we can respond in a proper way when the emergencies crops up. Strong product innovation capacity is something that is mandatory at this stage. So strong product innovation capacity aimed at developing travel options that are capable of offering the required vacation experience to customer in a safe, secured, and hassle-free way. The type of product that used to sell in the market pre-COVID are not going to sell in the days ahead. We need to innovate and work out something that will suit my customer, that is going to keep my customer safe, secured, and the ultimate objective should be that the customer should return back home with a good experience. In-depth destination knowledge, enabling identifying locations or spots or alternate tourism circuits, has potential to offer unique experiences to customers by being in harmony with the ecosystem. If I do not have in-depth knowledge of, say, Karnataka, I won't be able to select those destinations or those locations in Karnataka that are going to be alternate destinations to the known circuit. Any particular destination, whether it's Karnataka or a Tamil Nadu or a Himachal Pradesh, has got standard itineraries, the common itineraries through which people travel, the common places where people stay, the common sightseeings that normally a customer undertakes when they travel. These are no more sufficient. We have to bring up new destinations, we have to build fresh itineraries. We have to build fresh tourism circuits that gives a different type of an experience to our customer. Itinerary and logistic planning capacity is also to be built up. We have to build up very meticulously innovative itineraries in the days to come. Logistics planning, the route planning, whether my customer is going to fly, whether it will be good for my customer to fly or to travel on a train or to be on the roads. So this logistic planning will also be a very, very important factor as to how my customer is going to reach my destination. I have to have a personal heightened awareness on health and hygiene protocols. I need to be aware of the reasons of the factors that are creating COVID infection. At the same time, I need to know the way outs in which the contamination can be controlled. Sales skill is going to be an important area where I need to develop a very strong virtual selling skill. See, as of now, even if I ask my customer for an appointment, if I want to sit across the table and discuss with him, such opportunities, such appointments may not be given for obvious reasons. Virtual selling skills is to be strengthened in the sense I may have to complete my sales over phone. It can be a Zoom meeting with my customer. So this type of skills was not required in the pre-COVID time. People were happy meeting a travel professional in their residence, in their office. People used to visit our outlets, but gone are those days now for quite substantial time. I am now connected to my customer, maybe through Zoom, maybe through WhatsApp, through Facebook, or the best opportunity of speaking to my customer is obviously through my mobile. So virtual selling skills techniques upgradation is very important at this stage. Otherwise, I will lose out on my opportunity of setting up a relationship with the customer, explaining my product to the customer, and finally selling my product to the customer. This will require a very strong presentation capacity on the part of the travel salespeople. That brings us close to the areas where I thought I should highlight and speak on. And I will expect any questions, any observations or inputs any of you may be having at this stage.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very, very informative session. You have given us a snapshot of your own journey in this industry, as well as the profile and portfolio of Vacations Exotica and the recent trends in holidaying due to the COVID-19. You have elucidated thoroughly upon the survival strategy for the travel trade, the way forward, as well as the skill development needs for the future professionals. So keeping that in mind, there are a few questions from the end of our students. I would like to ask our students to please come on the screen. Just switch on your camera and you may start asking your questions. So we may start with the final year master's batch. If I'm okay. Audible to you, if you're there, you may ask the questions to sir. Sir, you may unshare your screen, sir.
Okay. Is it done, Vandita? It's okay?
Yes, sir, it is done. Yes, please post, please ask the first question.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Madhupriya. How are you?
Yes, sir, fine, sir. How are you, sir? Shubho Vijaya.
Shubho Vijaya, thank you so much. Tell me what you want to know.
I have a question that what can be the visible changes we can expect in the MICE industry post-COVID?
This is a very challenging area, Madhupriya, I should say, because MICE, the nature of MICE was group travel. 50 people, 100 people, 1500, 200, 2000 people traveling together. See, this mode of travel will take some time to develop itself now. As you can understand, We cannot sit together, we cannot gather together, we cannot be together during this period of time. So traveling in big volumes at this stage will not bring in a lot of pleasure. It is going to give rise to a lot of complications, which the corporates and business organizations will also understand. It's mainly a company's clients or a company's employees who travel together. Even these companies will also not be in a position to enable a group movement of their employees or their clients. It is not going to give them a good experience. It's going to create a lot of trouble for them. And yes, there is going to be a lot of restrictions from the authorities also. This may not be allowed. So till the time the vaccine comes out, and till the time the vaccine reaches each and every household in India, I don't see a big prospect in this area, whether domestic or international. It's definitely going to come up in a big way. But for a particular period of time, it's going to be a challenging area ahead.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
We can move on to the next question from our master student. If there is anything, you can please ask.
Am I audible?
Yes,
Sushmita. Hello, sir. Hello, ma'am.
Hello, Sushmita.
Yes, sir. I'm Sushmita. I'm doing a master's in tourism administration. I'm in the second year. Right. So, sir, I would like to know, could you please tell us more about the virtual selling skills?
I can give you an example. Say, for example, you are a travel professional selling international tours to your customer, okay? Where do you stay, Sushmita?
I stay in South Calcutta.
South Calcutta. So, for an example, you get in touch with a customer who stays in North Kolkata, okay? Now, there can be two way of communicating with your customer. One, you can be invited by your customer to his residence or his office for a direct interaction, where you sit face to face, speak to each other, understand your requirements, and you are able to finally present your package to your customer. The chances of this type of interactions in these COVID times are very less. You will have the second option of interacting over phone to your customer, in the sense that over phone, you can introduce yourself. You can take an update of your customer, the whereabouts of your customer. To some extent, you can even explain the itineraries to your customer. You can explain the nature of hotels and services that you are providing, that you are planning to provide to your customer. That will be one mode of communication. If your customer is still not convinced, you can connect to your customer maybe on WhatsApp video. You can connect to him on endless number of other apps that are available in the market at this moment. So you need to understand that, see, we are all human beings. We accept each other and reject each other through personal interactions, isn't it? Interacting with someone through phone, through artificial app, is something which is abnormal. But somehow this particular situation has given rise to a situation where we need to accept this abnormality, and we need to build up some skills to operate in this abnormality. There is no other option. If I can put up a mask and travel on the roads and be in office throughout the entire day, that's something abnormal also, but we are doing it anyhow. We are managing it. So on a sales level also, we need to have some tactics and some strategies and skills to complete a sale over phone. It's going to be a virtual world for quite some time now. Till everything settles down and your customer feels happy to sit across the counter with you, discuss on a destination, talk over a dream, and finally purchase a product from you. Are you convinced? That does it answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.
We can now move on to our final year bachelor students. So yes, sir, if you have any questions for sir, please ask.
Good evening, sir. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
So very good evening to you, sir. It's a pleasure having an opportunity to interact with you, sir.
Same here. It's a big opportunity for me also to meet you. I mean, all of you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, my question to you would be that, sir, what would be the major tourist concerns if they are approaching your organization for booking trips?
I should say the main concern at this moment is lack of confidence. There are 5-star hotels and 4-star hotels and 3-star hotels in today's COVID scenario. There were luxury deluxe properties earlier also. What is not there is confidence. People still have the resources and the wish to travel. They are unable to travel. It's only one factor. Lack of confidence and lack of morale, low morale, I should say. Till the time the confidence and high morale is returned back to the market, selling a package, I should say, is not impossible, but it's difficult. It's difficult for us travel professionals also to send someone out of his residence and bring him back home safe and sound. We need to take a lot of things into consideration while selling a package to our customer. Once only we are convinced that our guest is going to come back safe and sound and happy, on those circumstances and conditions only we are selling a package to our customer. We are also equally conscious with a lot of things. Does it answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your answer.
We can move on to the next question from our students. Please ask.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Shubhajit Mallik.
Afternoon, Shubhajit. How are you?
Sir, very good. How are you, sir?
Okay, good.
Sir, my question to you is, are group tours and escorted tours will be over forever after the COVID-19 era, post-COVID-19 era?
No, see, group departure, traveling in a group has always given a lot of convenience and a lot of benefits to the customer in the pre-COVID times. Convenience in the sense that if you are traveling out of your country or inside your country or out of your home for 14-15 days at a stretch, Shubhajit, you cannot be on your own for so long a time. And we Indians are all social people. We stay with our families. We don't have an individualistic societal system. If I am moving out of my home, my residence for 14 days, 15 days, 20 days, I cannot travel on my own. Indian needs a co-passenger who has to be an Indian. COVID has definitely given rise to a lot of complications that is not suiting group travel at this moment. But try and understand, this is a temporary phase going on. There were two world wars in the past, the First World War and the Second World War. But today's world is a globalized world. Today evening you want, tomorrow morning you can be in Toronto and you can be in Korea the next morning. It's a globalized world where you need to travel, you need to interact, you need to meet new people, you need to learn a lot of things, you need to unlearn a lot of things. So human being cannot stop traveling. Group tour, if not happening today, will definitely evolve in a different format in the coming days. There will be facilities included in those tours that is going to give a lot of confidence to the customers. It's just a period of time.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
For
sir.
Some period of time, people will travel FIT, they will travel on customized vacations. But once things settle down, yes, these groups may not be so big as the earlier ones. It may be small groups, 20-25 people traveling together. It will start like that, we expect.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sir. Thank you, sir.
We can move on to the next question if we have anything from our final year bachelor's batch.
Good evening, sir. Sir, this is Arpana from BATA semester 5.
Yeah, good evening, Arpana. Tell me.
Yes, sir. So my question is that, sir, do you think there will be more closer collaborations between the tourism industry and the health services industry, sir?
See, you are correct. You are on the right track. Though, I mean, even if it is not a direct collaboration, but yes, as on date, we are listening to doctors. We are complying to the SOPs laid down by the health authorities. In that way, we are definitely collaborating, assisting, and we are all a part of this particular fight against COVID. So in that way, you can think it is already a collaboration that has started. We will continue collaborating, coordinating, supporting, and assisting the health authorities in the coming days also. And it's not even the tourism industry and the health department that's going to cooperate and coordinate. I can say that it's already happening in all the segments. No one is operating single-handed now. There is continuous information and knowledge sharing that's happening between public and government authorities. So it's already on the process, and it's a good thing that's happening. This particular crisis situation has brought all of us together, so we are able to fight with some satisfaction with COVID, and after some time things will settle down also. That's my observation on the area that you have highlighted.
Thank you so much, sir, for your answer.
We can move on to the next question, please.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
My name is Rang from BATA 5. Okay, sir. So the important organizations like IATA, WTTC are predicting recovery for international tourist numbers by 2022. So my question to you, sir, is would it be wise for us students to continue with higher studies, especially like for us students who are in the last year for travel and tourism, sir?
See, travel and tourism as an industry had grown over the years. Human beings, since they started migrating from one continent to other continent, though it was not exactly tourism at that stage, but that was something human, something normal that happened. Without it, it required no catalyst. People started moving out of Africa and they slowly spread across the world. Travel is something that is going to stay and that is going to evolve and mature up in a far better way than what has happened in the East areas. If you are thinking about higher studies, I will definitely give you green signal to go ahead. Higher studies is always going to mature you up. It's going to increase your bandwidth. It's going to put up somewhere where you will be able to share that knowledge with your juniors. It's always something which is always good. You're on the right track. Don't get demotivated by the last 6 months happenings in market. These are all things which are temporary. It will wash out.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for clearing my doubts.
Thank you.
I believe we just have a couple of few questions, sir. This is from our bachelor's second year. So they have a couple of questions for you. Okay. So can we have the first question, please?
Good evening, sir, and one law present out here.
Yeah, tell me. Hello.
My name is Prema and I'm from BATA.
Yes, Prema, tell me, I can hear you.
I believe there is some issue on the net connection. Actually, yeah. She happens to be one of our international from Bhutan. Okay, I guess we can move on to the next question because she is not
already. My question to you is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, can we have the next question, please? She's having internet trouble. She is connecting all the way from Bhutan, actually. So there are issues. Okay. Can we have the next question, please?
Good evening, sir. Myself, Gloria, and I'm a bachelor's student of second year. So, sir, my question is, how should the future aspirants of the tourism industry prepare themselves for the career in the industry post COVID-19? And so what extra do they need to put in?
I can suggest you to work strongly in three directions. You need to absorb whatever is being delivered to you in your college, because that will give you a lot of mileage once you grow up in your career. Develop destination knowledge, study the itineraries that are available in the market. For an example, study the company's website, see what type of itineraries they have developed, study the destination, understand the itinerary flow. I mean, traveling to, for an example, if you want to travel to Madhya Pradesh, you cannot visit each and every city of Madhya Pradesh. It is not required also. So you need to know the destinations in Madhya Pradesh that you need to travel. You also need to have a very thorough understanding as to the local attractions those destinations are throwing open to you. And you must also know how to travel and what are the avenues of traveling to a particular destination. So do a lot of studies online, a lot of information, a lot of itineraries and travel options are available on online. Study the website of the established tour operators. Read good journals and travel magazines. For an example, read Outlook Traveler. You can also subscribe to Lonely Planet. Whatever resource, whatever source of knowledge is available in and around you, make best utilization of it. Develop a better capacity, develop a capacity of presenting a particular thought to your audience. It will not happen overnight. You have to keep on practicing so that you can speak out clearly and your message is being communicated in a very clear way to the person you are communicating with so that he is able to respond to you. So gather as much knowledge as possible. If possible, travel, start traveling to destinations. Read about the destinations, observe the market as to which are the companies that are operating in the market, try to understand their business strategy, take a listing of the range of products that they are selling in the market. This is something which as a travel student, if you are practicing from now onwards, at the time of your first entry to the market, I think you will be far ahead. At least you will have some concept clear in your mind. You will know what your organization will expect out of you. And you will also know how and in what way you can contribute to your organization. Got it?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Can we quickly move on to any last questions that we have?
Good evening, one second, sir.
Good evening, good evening. Thank you for trying and connecting back.
My name is Pem Lam, and I'm from Bata third semester.
Right.
Firstly, I would like to thank sir for this golden opportunity and sparing your precious time to enlighten us on our very industry. My question to you is, how can the tourism professionals train themselves to deal with the heightened sense of fear and perceive risks in tourists right now due to COVID-19, sir?
Pema, you need to develop a list of destinations which has already opened up you need to select the hotels in those destinations. Those hotels only who are complying to the SOPs laid down by the local authorities. Those destinations which has got a direct connectivity to the place from which your customer is originating his or her journey. And taking everything, especially all these things into consideration, put your steps into a customer's footsteps and understand and think as if you are a customer. Do an exercise like that. Think that you are traveling or you are thinking about a travel to that particular destination. If you feel confident, your customer is also going to feel confident. So you need to do a lot of homework. These homeworks are going to give you confidence. Like for an example, among all the other states that have opened up till now in India, Goa is the only destination that is drawing, that has started drawing a lot of tourists. There is a lot of positivity happening in Goa. So select those destinations which has already opened their border. Select those destinations where the hoteliers of that particular place, the local government and authorities of their particular place themselves are providing confidence to the customers. Try and sell those destinations only, rather than those destinations where the local authorities have taken a conservative attitude. You need to do a lot of market research at this stage. Only when you as a travel professional is convinced, your customer is going to be convinced. Otherwise, travel will take a lot of time to come back. People, till the time, if they don't have that confidence, if they are still in that demoralized stage, it is bad for our industry.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir, first of all, thank you for, you know, patiently answering all the questions. We still have got two questions left from the end of our students. So I'll just quickly ask them to pose the questions. Yes.
Sure, definitely.
Students, please ask the questions.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir. So my question to you will be, what are the few inherent weaknesses that COVID-19 has revealed about the tourism industry?
I can identify one area in which the industry was operating over capacity. Over capacity in the sense, it did not have the required infrastructure and consciousness to handle the volume of traffic that it was handling earlier. Too many hotels cramped in one particular location. Too many people cramped in one particular destination. These are all scenarios or weaknesses as rightly highlighted that you have highlighted. These are the weaknesses areas on which the industry partners should work on. If these are not rectified or modified, then, I mean, getting back customers, getting back passengers and visitors is going to be a big challenge ahead. You need to give a lot of space, a lot of independence and freedom to people from now onwards. People are intelligent. They know what is what. They observe a lot of things. They take a decision also at their end. So, I mean, if you are not prepared, I am not prepared in the right way, with the right infrastructure, we cannot convince our customers.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, the last question, please, for the day.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Myself, Dikshita Smith, sir. So my question is, how can tourism brands look forward to differentiate their offerings in post-COVID-19 era?
It was a part of one of my slides earlier. You need to start innovating, Dikshita. You need to start innovating. You need to start remodeling and rebuilding things. If it is not done, the old product is not going to be accepted in the market. You have to provide something new to your customer, something reliable and something genuine to your customer, so that it is being purchased by the customer. Constant innovation, development, reassurance, all these human aspects, I should say, has to be brought forth so that it is accepted in a human way and things falls back into shape.
Thank you, sir. Hope you have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Okay. I believe we are done with all the questions. Do we have anything else, anything especially from the end of our final year master student? We can take one last or else we will round up the session.
Ma'am, can I speak?
Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, sir. My name is Salome.
Good evening, Salome.
Good evening, sir. So thank you so much for sharing such details and answering our questions. My question to you is, sir, so what has made you interested in this field, and how are you so motivated still because of the COVID-19? Like, we students, personally, we were quite demotivated and we were quite uncertain about our future. So I would like to know what has motivated you and how are you still on track and in the same area?
See, Saloni, we are in an industry which gets affected by a lot of things. I will give you examples so that you understand it better. Vidhan Sabha elections and Lok Sabha elections happens at periodic intervals in India. People stop traveling during these times. That affects the sales of our industry. This was just a small example. A volcano in Indonesia erupts and people stop traveling to Indonesia. Okay. An earthquake happens in Japan and people stop traveling to Japan. There's a war in Syria. Israel is continuously fighting with someone. We are fighting with our neighbors. But does travel stop? People are still traveling. Me and you are traveling. We are happy. So there will be a lot of things happening around you, Saloni, continuously. You cannot, these things should not create a strong impact on you. This will be a part and parcel of our life. Anna? There are a lot of things which will continuously happen in and around you that will, sometime it will hit you so badly that you will fall down. Sometime it will hit you so severely that you will get demotivated. But you need to take it in a intelligent way that these are all temporary things. These are not going to continue. If COVID is not going to get controlled, all of us are going to die. But do you think all of us will die? We will not die. So it's just a temporary thing. It may take a year. It may take more than a year, but at some point of time, there will be a medicine that will come up that will stop COVID. There are a lot of other deadly diseases also in this world, which were stopped by a medicine. So you need to give time. Vaccine is no magic that I press a button and the vaccine comes out. It's not like a thumbs up dispenser. People need to work very hard. That is the researchers, that is what they are doing. People are working extremely hard to come out with a medicine so that you and me can have it and improve our immunity. You need to give time, boss. Have patience.
Yes.
Okay, I believe with that, sir, we can end the session for the day. Thank you, sir, once again for taking our time for this and being patient with the questions. May I now request our head of the institute, Professor Siddharth Nanda, sir, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your valuable inputs.
Thank you so much, Mr.
How patiently and how in a simple way you have answered the questions of the students.
It's always a very fresh experience to talk to people, to accept their questions, to give them valuable inputs. It's a great experience for us also.
Yes, it's a great learning, in fact, for all of us. How do we deal with questions with a lot of patience and a lot of the simplest way you have explained, citing different examples to make them really understand, and the inputs that you have given is really enriching. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
And we wish you a good health, and please, we'll always be, you know, lucky and happy to be associated with you in the future.
Same here.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Vandita.